We hear in our gospel reading for today two connected accounts of interactions between Jesus and his disciples. As we read these accounts, we hear of transformations that are happening. Transformations in the ministry of Jesus and transformation in the relationship that Jesus has with his disciples and in the lives of the disciples themselves as they come to understand and know what it is to be a follower of Jesus. As we first encounter Jesus this morning, he has arrived in his hometown, a place where you might expect to be greeted warmly, where folks know who you are and love you because, hey, you're Mary and Joseph's son. We remember you. But instead, Jesus shows up and the people are questioning him. Where does he get this power from? What's going on with him? Why is he doing that? Why is he behaving that way? It makes me think about our own ways of approaching situations and people. We might have in our own minds the way a situation is supposed to be, how we expect it to be. We may have in our own minds how we expect a person to behave, how we expect and know that a person in this position, in this place, is supposed to behave in this way. And then when it doesn't happen, we become disappointed and angry and maybe even hostile towards them. I must confess to you that my mother had a friend with whom I interacted with her in a bad way. She was a bit pushy. She wanted to be a part of our family prior to our willingness to receive her in that way. She wanted to be involved with more and more parts of our mother's life that I was like, whoa, wait a minute. That's too much, too fast. She was difficult to get along with in my mind. She kind of rubbed me in all the wrong ways. You may know somebody like that in your life who's rubbed you in the wrong way for really maybe no apparent reason at all, except that's how this was, and I didn't take to it very well. And I pushed her away, and in so doing, hindered the friendship being established between she and my mother. It was not a good situation, but it was what it was, and I must confess that I felt kind of good about it. Yes, I got rid of her. Got my mother back. Yeah, that's pretty bad, isn't it? Maybe that's the way the people feel in Jesus' hometown. You know, they're not sure. He's not behaving like a carpenter's son. Why is he having all this wisdom? Where does that come from? How can he cure and heal people? Carpenters don't do that. He's not behaving like a carpenter's son, and he's not behaving like the Messiah, the Son of God, either. And so they don't know what to make of him. And so they do what many of us do when we're confronted with people we don't understand. They pushed him away, and he was met with hostility. Now, we're told that he was able to go about and did, in fact, cure a few people, but then he left. And he went off to some other villages. There maybe he might be better received. And as he was going on his way, realized that, you know, this ministry, this work of the kingdom, the announcement of God's kingdom coming near is bigger than I am. And it's bigger than I'm able to do. And so I need others with me to do this. And Jesus called the 12. And he gathered with him others, those disciples who were at first observers, just watchers, watching what Jesus did, following along behind him like a good student would follow a teacher, now become the sent ones, the ones who Jesus calls and gathers with him and equips them and then gives them the authority to go out, to teach and to preach and to cure and to be disciples of the Rabbi Jesus. He tells them, though, not to take anything. That always surprises me because I'm one who really loves to pack. And I'm inclined to carry many bags with me, so I have lots of options of what to do. You know, you never quite know what you might need in any given time. And I might want to choose a different outfit on a different day than I maybe planned the first time. So I got to have stuff with me. But Jesus says to his disciples, you're going to go out with nothing but the tunic, your staff, and your sandals. Don't even take an extra tunic. Don't take any money. Just go. And they went. And they went, trusting in the one who's called them and equipped them and who sends them to go. It's interesting to me that Jesus, here in his hometown, is faced with no hospitality from those who live there. Instead, he's met with anger and disdain, hostility. And then he sends his disciples out to be dependent on the hospitality of others. One who has received no hospitality sends others out in his name to be dependent on the hospitality of others. That's interesting to me, and maybe to you. And so we, my sisters and brothers, are sent ones. We are sent forth with the gifts that God has given to us to rely on the power of God's presence in our lives. We are sent forth, but not alone. We are sent forth two by two. As Mark says, we're sent forth in community, not to be dependent on ourselves, but dependent on the hospitality of others, dependent on the companionship and the camaraderie and the shared mission and possibility with those who link arms with us, who go forth with us in the name of Jesus. We are sent forth as those disciples are sent forth. And we too are equipped with what we need. Everything we need to be about the work that God gives us to do, we have right here, right now. We just need to unleash it, uncover it, to recognize it. Each of you have been gifted for ministry in particular ways. You have spiritual gifts. You have passions. You have abilities. You have experiences. You have the unique person that you are that is unlike anyone else that you can bring to the table to share in the work of ministry. From the littlest one in our congregation to the oldest, we all are necessary and needed to be about the work of the kingdom that God gives us to do here. And so in the next months or so, we're going to be figuring that out. And we're going to use a process called SHAPE to help us uncover what are our spiritual gifts? What are our passions? What is the shape that we are as individuals? And what's the shape of this congregation? And just like puzzle pieces, how do these shapes fit together? For the glory of God, for the work of the kingdom, we are sent forth to be God's people in this time and place, gifted with all that we need, so that we are dependent on God and united with others, interdependent on one another. We need each other to be about the work of the kingdom. Maybe that's right here in this congregation, but more likely, it's where you are, where you live, where you work, where you go to school, your communities, your social clubs. That's where the ministry happens, outside of the walls of this church. We are compelled and sent to go. The good news is that I realize the hardness with which I accepted this person in my mother's life, because I realize how much it hurt my mother. And because I love my mother, I began to love this woman for the goodness that she was for my mother. And our relationship was restored through those interactions with each other. It's that kind of hospitality with which we are called to share, a hospitality of love. We might not like all the people we encounter along the way to which God sends us. We may not like the places where we're sent to go and to be, but we love Jesus, And because we love Jesus, we are going to love the people that Jesus loves. And the people that Jesus loves are the people who are waiting to receive us, to welcome us, so that we can use those gifts, use our unique shape to go forth to be God's people, leaning into the promises of God, who says, "My grace is sufficient for you." So go. Go. Be the people God has created us to be. Amen.